Good evening, everybody. That's a very effective microphone. First of all, a very great welcome to everybody here. It's really delightful to see so many Darwin faces come along to talk to and hear from two amazing, amazing women. This particular event is the final one in the series of events that Noeline Brown, Ambassador for Ageing, has taken place in the Territory this week. We've worked hard, starting at Alice Springs, working up through Catherine, Adelaide River, today at Palmerston, and tonight, Darwin. We thank you very much, Noeline, for that heavy commitment, and I'm hoping your first trip to the Territory is not your last. Tonight for me is a really special occasion. Noeline Brown has been a role model for me, and I said to her earlier today that back in the 70s I was a shy, retiring type, and all those friends don't laugh. And I saw on television a confident, articulate, funny example of womanhood, which was Noeline Brown in Mavis Bramston, and she really encouraged me in myself to try and figure out how I could make the best of the skills and talents that I had. I'm sure that you're going to love listening to Noeline's story, and it's colourful, and I'm not going to try and predict what's going to be said, other than to welcome Noeline to the pedestal to talk about the Noeline Brown story. Thank you very much, Noeline.
Thank you, Robin. The one thing we didn't discuss is how long am I supposed to speak? Okay, I think we've set our watches for about 20 minutes. I have a few acknowledgements. I'm new to town, so Alison Anderson, Minister for Women's Affairs, Sally Seavers, Anti-Discrimination Commissioner, Robin Leslie, CEO of COTA, Monica Stewart, Champion Extraordinaire. Where are you, Monica? Oh, congratulations. I know you're going to speak after me, so you know you've got 20 minutes. I would like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners and custodians of the land we meet on today. It's an absolute honour and a privilege to be here. I've been the Ambassador for Ageing for a little over 5 years, and in that time I've been desperate to get to the Territory. And I remember asking the question, aren't there any old people in the Northern Territory? Because we respond to invitations. When I say we, I travel with Tony McLennan from the Department of Health and Ageing. She's here today. So we really respond to invitations from the community to attend their events, to talk about positive stories about ageing. So that's really my job, my current job. But when I first started as in the workforce, I left school at 15 years of age, which was common in those days for women. I'm sure a number of the women in the audience here today would have done so, because you didn't actually waste an education on a woman because she was going to get married anyway and have children and never work again. So I was lucky because my first and only job, apart from being an actor and later the Ambassador for Ageing, was in the local public library. And to me, I'd spent my life at school, in the last few years anyway, regarded as a naughty girl who was always out in the corridor for having that look on my face. I never found out what the look was, but I was a very shy kid, and I was always astonished that I got into so much trouble. I think it might have been the fact that my hair was always hanging over my eyes, and my teachers used to get a bobby pin and go, stick it up there, because it irritated them. So I was an irritating child. But I was lucky because I saw an ad in the paper for a library assistant. and it was at the local library in Marrickville, which is a working class suburb of Sydney, New South Wales. So I went along to audition for my first job. My mum came too on the 412 bus to Marrickville. And I was interviewed by the mayor and several other, maybe they were older persons, I don't know, but all I remember was being a shy kid, stammering my answers to the questions. And at that meeting, the mayor said, well, really, you can't have this job of a library assistant because you really need the leaving certificate, as it was then. So I was very disappointed, and I went home on the bus with my mother telling me I told you so, because she had wanted me to stay back at school, but I was desperate to leave. So a week later in the mail came a letter from the mayor saying, although we can't offer you the job of assistant librarian, we can offer you the job of a library assistant, or the reverse, I can't remember, but I thought it was so close that that will do. And indeed, I started a job doing the normal things of putting books on shelves and doing all that stuff. But what I found was I loved to do research. And just here I was in a university. That's how I felt about my library life, that all these books were available. Art was my love, and literature. So I was in heaven. I was also a bit naughty because I'd never get in on time, but I was allowed to do that because I would stay till 7 o'clock at night because I was so involved in what I was doing. And the chief librarian was a wonderful mentor to me, and her name was Frances Charteris. She's very well known in the library world, and Frances saw in me some talents, that I was quite good at art, so she'd give me work to do for book week, designing stuff, and also she had me writing for the, we had a little magazine, so I could write reviews for the magazine. But I used to go to the theatre, and there was a theatre in Sydney, a review theatre called Phillip Street, if anybody remembers that. It was the beginning of the Mavis Bramston show, really. So I'd come back to the work the next day, a little bit late, and do the sketches, and have, you know, I just had a lot of fun going to those shows. But she believed that I probably should go to a local theatre and work as an actress. So she encouraged me to go along to what was called the Pocket Playhouse. The Pocket Playhouse was, it was in an old Rechabite Hall. They'd gutted and made into a little amateur theatre, which actually only held about 70 or 80 people. But it was a children's theatre and a theatre for adults. So it would work from Thursdays to Sundays, and we would do several children's shows, and then we'd do a different show for adults at night. So it was a wonderful experience for me. It was a real jump into the deep end of the swimming pool and learn to swim. So that's exactly what I did. But it was interesting because the very first show that I auditioned for was The Sleeping Prince by Terence Rattigan, which was written for Laurence Olivier and Vivian Leigh when they were together. And oddly enough, while I was playing the character that was written for Vivian Leigh, she came to Australia. She came with the Old Vic Theatre Company. And we were all at a party together, given by Robert Hughes, who became later on a very well-known critic, and I was sure everybody would know Bob. So at the party that Bob gave in his mother's house in the garden, Vivian Leigh was present, looking every inch the star in little pedal pushers and a very large hat. And I remember she took far too great an interest in my boyfriend, Robert Hughes. I was a bit put out. But at the party, she showed some interest in going to see the show that we were in, that was written for her. And of course, the director of the show, who was also there, was delighted and invited her. So, on a Sunday night, a special performance of The Sleeping Prince was given for Vivian Leigh and her partner at the time, John Merivale. And they arrived, I might tell you where this theatre was, it was in Tempe, Sydenham, and in those days it was right across the Prince's Highway from Tempe Tip. So it's a very downmarket little area. So all of the neighbours were astonished to see a big black limo arrive, and it disgorged John Merivale first, and he opened the door for Vivian Leigh, who stepped out looking every inch the star in a little black dress by Dior, obviously, and a fur piece and a tiny little hat and beautiful diamonds and pearls. And she obviously, the neighbours were very aware of who she was, because she would have been one of the most famous film stars because of Gone with the Wind. So they came in to see the show, and I can't tell you how terrible we were. We were absolutely appalling, and I can only just imagine her thinking, God, when we can get out of here. So we, after the show was over, thank God it was over, she came up onto the stage, and there was a presentation of a painting by a local painter, Tom Gleghorn, who was quite well known, and a beautiful bunch of flowers, of course. So she stood on the stage with all of these beautiful gifts, and she was absolutely luminous. And all you can see of myself on the stage is, she stood right in front of me for the photograph, so all you can see is my feet and a little ghostly shadow, which is pretty much how I felt on the night. But I can honestly say that I shared a stage with Vivian Leigh. Now, I only tell this story because of the gratitude I have for a person who saw in me some quality, and that was my mentor. And Frances and I are still friends. She's a painter now, she lives in Rockhampton, and she's well in her 80s, and it's been a delight to have that relationship with her all these years. But I might also say that the show was actually a great success, and we got very good notices, and it launched me into a career in show business. So I was actually headhunted for the Phillip Street Theatre, the very show, the very theatre that I'd always wanted to perform in. So I left the library. But I had been there for 8.5 years, from the time I was 15 to my very first stage professional performance. So if I would not have been where I was or where I am or who I am if I had not had that friendship and support from this powerful woman. So we're talking about powerful women here today, because many of my friends may not have had the same opportunities that I have had because of their expectations and the fact that they went in to do typing and shorthand and so on. And a lot of them may have stayed doing those tasks till they were able to marry. I'm sure a lot of girls just filled in time till they were married. And I always thought that that would happen to me, that I would marry young and have children. And I did meet a very nice man, and he was a lovely bloke, and my parents all approved, and I was engaged at 18. He was perfect. He was the most gorgeous man. He would have done anything for me. But a year passed, and I was 19 by then, and I'd fallen in love with the theatre. And I thought, I have to do something else. I cannot imagine marrying, having children, and doing nothing else. So that decision I made at that age, I don't think anyone influenced me. I just knew that I had something else ahead of me. So that's really my story of how I got into show business. And what it's opened for me, you know, the many, many doors that it's opened for me, and I might have a glass of water in a moment.
Excuse me. Thank you. Thank you.
I encourage you to drink a lot of water because as you get older, a lot of things dry out. So, anyway, I've had a long career in show business, but I guess when we're talking about women and, you know, opportunities for women, we should talk about ourselves. So I hope you don't mind me doing that, because everybody in this room has their own story of how they got to where they are today, and I think we should all share them, and that's something I talk about in my role as Ambassador for Ageing. Now, I've been in show business for 51 years. I started in 1962. So in that time, I've done a lot of other things that involved caring for people. And that's my other passion, is volunteering. And as the Ambassador for Ageing, which was a job that I was given a little over 5 years ago, I think it was probably a suggestion from Council on the Ageing that they would like, older Australians would like to have somebody representing them in the community, talking about positive stories about ageing, because all you ever hear is the sky is going to fall in because in 40 years' time, 1 in 4 of the total population is going to be 65 years and over. Well, from my point of view, at 74 years of age, 65 is very young. So the sky is not going to fall in because we're better educated than we've ever been. We're healthier than we've ever been. We're more independent financially than we've ever been. So we have a lot to offer. So, having been asked to take this role on, I thought it was a terrific opportunity to be able to use my media skills, if I have them, to get those stories out about positives, about ageing. So that's what I've been doing for the last 5 years, and also passing on messages about how to keep healthy and active and, you know, I do say you've got to eat all your vegetables, stop smoking, have exercise, all of that other stuff. But you also have to be involved. And friendships come and go, people leave. I haven't met anyone from the Territory. They've all moved here. So people lose their old friends. It's really, really important to join organisations where you can make new friends. And you can have conversations with people who don't agree with you, because all your old friends say, oh yes, yes, isn't it terrible, isn't it terrible, we agree. It's much better to be challenged and say, oh, I hadn't thought of that before, or no, I definitely do not believe you, this is my point of view, and so on. That's stimulating, it's wonderful. So for every person, whether they're male or female, it's really important that we do that. Women do it better than men, of course, because they always have. But men have their men's shed, which has changed everything dramatically, because men will talk about things that concern them to other men, whereas they wouldn't like to talk about it in front of the women folk. So those are the sort of things that I promote wherever I go. I also promote health messages like bowel screening and the flu shots and getting yourself checked and making sure you look after your health. I talk about those things as well. But this position has been one of the most interesting that I've ever had because I've met so many interesting people. Everyone has a story, as I've said many times, but and they should all write it down. But I've met so many interesting people, mainly women, because women do join. They join organisations, they run those organisations, and I do believe it's because they start when they've got their kids in school and that sort of thing. So the opportunities that are available for women now are so much better than they've ever been. I meet women, powerful women in important roles now, where they would have been one or two, they would have been sort of regarded as freaks when I was a young person. So, and everyone would say, does your husband let you do this? That sort of thing. I mean, I've even had that in the 37 years that I've been married to my husband. People have actually said, oh, your husband doesn't mind if you go on tour. Oh, no, he doesn't mind if I go on tour. I don't mind if he does. He's a writer-producer, and we often used to just see each other at the letterbox coming and going. But he's a really supportive person. He loves what I do, and I had to ring him because a job has been offered to me, and negotiations are taking place, and this is with the ABC and the company that's organising it. I haven't got my diary here, I don't know anything about it. So I rang my husband and I said, darling, could you help me out? Can you do this and work out the dates and everything? Happily, he said. So he's my amanuensis, which is really nice. It's a role reversal. So what I love about today's, the people of today, the men will take, they used to take out the garbage and the women would do the cooking. All the young men I know now treat their women as absolute equals and the chores are shared. Whoever gets home first does the cooking. I think that's really fabulous. I mean, I actually like cooking. I love entertaining, but I love the fact that when I come home from a gig, my husband's actually got the dinner on the table. I think that's really, really healthy. Things have changed, but they haven't changed enough. We're still behind the eight ball when it comes to how much we get paid in the workforce. It's probably still so in show business. We don't get the opportunity to be the kingpin, so I don't think there's a woman who would get as much pay as a male in the same role if they were hosting. So I know that there's something like a 20% difference in the territory, and it's a little bit less, 17% I think, difference in other states, but I don't believe that's fair, and I think that we should work hard to improve that. We should close that gap. And I know that in some cases people are employing women because they're cheaper, and I don't think that's fair. So we have to change those things. We have to change those attitudes. We have to get more women into Parliament, although that's getting better and better. And it's wonderful to see the difference in those 50 years that I have seen, when all you would have expected to be was somebody's secretary. When you would have been typing and doing shorthand and everything, for a man who couldn't even, I mean, he could sign the letter and he could tell you what he wanted in the letter, but he couldn't use a typewriter. And I have a friend who's a very powerful man, and he started his life in advertising and he ran a huge company. Then he went to work for another organisation. He was headhunted for this. And he said he went there and he said he didn't get an office. He was shocked. He had like a corral, a little part of an open office. And he said, you should have seen my office. He said, I've got this corner somewhere. But he couldn't even use a computer. He wrote everything by longhand because he expected some woman to do it for him. So it was a huge experience for him to go into this modern workforce. So I think that's marvellous now, that we can all take on those roles, that we don't just go, yes sir, three bags full sir. When the Girl Friday ran the department and even had to go and collect the dry cleaning, I'm sure, and buy a present for the boss's wife. So I'm glad to say that we don't do that anymore, and we all get our own coffee. So I'll probably go to questions now, if anybody has any questions about the role of ambassador for ageing, or even about show business, I don't mind. So I've had a big day, so I hope I can remember a few things.
Any questions?
There's a hat, yes. Oh, we've got a microphone, that's good.
Thank you so much, Noeline. Pam Robinson. I'm formerly employed with local government. I'm with the City of Palmerston and have previously been with the City of Durham. First of all, just a little part of your acting. When you say Phillip Street, there were a lot of smiles around the place. We are of that era. I came from Melbourne. It was pram factory time and a lot of great people came from that.
Yes.
But I just want to put to you that it is a changing time. I'll be 70 next year. You know, there are corners you'd say that and there are corners you wouldn't, because there's still that people start to think about it, whereas totally inside me, I don't think about it at all. Mm. So I just want to say that another role I have is as president of the Northern Territory Women and Local Government Association. And one of the things that they have is a 50-50 gender equity, which has been a new program, but for the goal level on that is looking at putting in there that in fact the ageing issue of employment within local government. Local government could be champions to take the real meaning of working longer, and it's a real opportunity. I was just wondering, within your own journeys and places that you've been, have you heard any discussion at all in terms of the best ways or avenues or examples of where, in fact, the issue of future employment is just not an issue? It's never going to be an issue for me personally. I'm sure I'll be working till I'm 80. Mm. And that's partly a financial situation, and it's also, I'm widowed, so you know, it's a life for me, but I'm not doing it because I have to. But at the same time, I do it joyfully, and I take your point, I live a full life and excitedly. But I think there's still, whilst Peter Costello started that conversation, I think it's tailed off about working on, and I'm just wondering if you could comment on that.
The question is probably working longer and encouraging employers to think about choosing older workers. I guess that's the way to look at it, because wherever I go, I do hear people say they want to work longer, and sometimes, as you pointed out, they have to work longer. But the big thing is trying to encourage employers to use older people. Now, I do let people know in my talks that older people are very good employees, that they work longer, they're more loyal, they don't take any more time off work than younger people, but the main thing they do is they love their jobs, especially if somebody's been out of the workforce for any length of time. That's when they become really, really loyal, because they're grateful for the job. A couple of times I've talked about older people not wanting to feel invisible. And I said at one function, the only time I've ever felt invisible was at Bunnings, because I'd waited a very long time to get served. And it got a big laugh, but a woman came up to me afterwards and said, oh, please don't say that about Bunnings, because they actually employ older workers. So I've stopped saying that about Bunnings, and do encourage other people to know that Bunnings does this, and they're very happy with their workers, and their workers are very, very happy. So they're productive, and you know, they're tapping into, I always say that we are not, we are there to be mined. Older Australians are there, they should be tapping into our wisdom and mining all the stuff that we've got inside us. So we shouldn't be regarded as you know, frail and sitting, waiting to go into a nursing home or being in an aged care facility. I do point out that only 6% of older Australians are actually in nursing homes. The rest of us are out there in the community, still working, many working into their hundreds. I'm sure we all heard the story recently about a woman who went to work in her shop every day till, and she was 108 or something, unbelievable. Very, very elderly person. Good on her. That would be keeping her alive and interested and vital. So it's very good that the council is doing that. I congratulate them. Any more questions? They're very shy, aren't they?
Maybe if I could ask a question.
Yes.
I'm interested in your comment about the potential conflict between generations, and how we can actually take younger people with us so that we're not seen as all the stereotype images of seniors.
We want to stop younger people regarding seniors as frail and not as important as they are. Is that the question? I think the only way we can do that is by being out there and by not being invisible either, because sometimes I've been to functions with older people saying sometimes it's our fault that we're invisible, and I think that that might be true. You know, there are amazing organisations out there like the Red Hat Ladies. They're never going to be invisible. I love that. I thought when I first met them, they were just a bit silly and they just went out to lunch, till I found out the background of the Red Ladies, that their aim is to help people, to go to people who might be, they might be lonely, they might be widowed, they might be frightened to go out. So they drag them out and they put a red hat on them, or a purple hat and a feather boa, and they have a great time and they are not invisible. So I think it's up to us in a way, and it's up to us to still relate to younger people, to have younger people as our friends. There are a lot of younger people here today, but I'm talking about myself as representative of an older group. It's very important for us to have friends of all ages, so we know their issues and they know ours, because we always get it wrong. You know, I often hear people say, oh, the young people of today. Well, they're no different from the young people of when we were young people. It's just that we should remember what we were like when we were young. But it's, I have friends of all ages, and I honestly do not know how old I am, because when I'm with my 30-year-old friends, I feel 30. When I'm with my young nephews, I feel quite young. So I'm sure we're all the same, that nobody feels their age. My grandmother was 84 when I asked this question, and she said, I still feel 14. So I think inside of us, we're all young people, so it's very, very important that we do exchange ideas. No more questions.
No, I'm sure they're going to be.
Here's one. Thank you. I must say, everybody in the Territory sells the Territory. Everywhere I've gone, people say how much they love being here. And I've heard people with accents from all over the world, and they just adore it. Now, I know it's beautiful, it's hot, and it is physically a very, very beautiful place, but it can't just be the physicality of the place that makes people love it so much. It must be the people and the organisations and friendships and whatever. It is a lovely place, but the gorgeous thing is everybody loves it so much that they want you to come and live here. So you never know when the Southern Highlands of New South Wales gets too cold, and believe me it has, we might be travelling north. No more questions? I might pass it over to Robin now. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. It's been gorgeous. Thank you.
Thanks very much, everybody. I'm sure that Monica and Noeline will be available for photographs and conversations at the end of the session. But before we go into our second speaker, there's one thing that I did omit to do earlier on today, and that is to thank the sponsors who are responsible for bringing today together. Initially, it was a project of the Office of Women's Advancement, which was about conversations with women. And when we were talking about holding it and focusing on senior women, the opportunity presented itself to make Noeline available here as well. So this is predominantly an event sponsored by the Office of Women's Advancement and the Council of the Aging in the Northern Territory. But there's also, I wanted to thank the Department of Health and Ageing responsible for the Ambassador for Ageing program, and also for Crocodilus, who have given some financial support to us. So thank you for those sponsors and supporters. Our next speaker is Monica Stewart. Monica probably could be condensed down into the teacher, the aviator, and the sportswoman. First coming to the Northern Territory in 1974, she has a very interesting story about the bush and progressing through to her amazing athletic feats and continued aspirations. So I hand it over to you, Monica, and look forward to the Monica Stewart story. Thank you.
Sorry, I'm a real territorian. I have to put this jacket on. It's just a bit too cold. It is very cold. Okay, I arrived in Darwin when I was a young 21-year-old teacher with my friend Jill, who just qualified as a nurse from Melbourne. And the first couple of days up here, we decided we were going to warm our bodies up. Just coming from Melbourne, it had been a very bitter winter. So we hired a mini moke and we drove out heading toward Casuarina Beach, when I said to Jill, I'm not too sure about the fuel gauge on this one. We'll just pull in and top it up. While we're in there, the gentleman at the Ludmilla BP was filling the car up, the moke, and he said, girls, are you off to the beach? And we said, yes, yes. We haven't been to the beach for how many months? It's been freezing in Melbourne. And he said, oh, be careful of the sea wasps. And Jill and I looked at each other and we thought, gee whiz. Down in Victoria we get these wasps, I think they're European wasps. And Jill said, are they anything? I wonder if they're anything like that. And I said, I don't know, but he said they're deadly. So anyway, we got back in the moke and away we go. We get to Casuarina Beach and I said to her, I think, Jill, we better be a bit cautious here. You put your towel that way and I'll watch the water that way in case they come flying by. So we've got our books out and our little thermos and really enjoying the warmth in our bodies. Next minute I look up and I can see something like a swarm coming by. And I said, Jill, I think they're here. So we grabbed our towels and the thermos and we ran for the moke. And of course the moke had no doors on it, it was just rolled up. And I said, I'll get the curtains down if you get the towel happening so they don't get inside. Anyway, so a couple of days later we found ourselves back at the same servo. And I said to the gentleman, I must thank you for warning us about the sea wasps. we were relaxing back on the beach, and I said, I saw them flying around the corner. And he said to me, really? He said, they were dragonflies. So that was the introduction to the territory, and I thought, gee whiz, I am really green. I hadn't really been out of Victoria very much, and I'd spent the first 21 years of my life studying. And another funny thing too I must relate to you is about the flying fox. That was another thing that I had to come to terms with. We were playing cricket on the beach at Micah Beach, and someone said, I said, what was that? I just saw a shadow of something, and they said, oh, it was a flying fox. I'm thinking, woo, a flying fox? Because I'd come from Victoria off a farm, and we sort of we hunted the foxes when because they used to attack our lambs, and I'm thinking, a flying one, wow. This territory is pretty special. So anyway, at the end of the 2 weeks, Jill went back to Melbourne, and I accepted a teaching position down at Wave Hill. I had to look on the map to see where it was, and just the experience flying down there was pretty exciting for me. It was in a Dove. I don't know whether you know the aircraft. It's has old leaky doors. Anyway, I was in amongst all the cargo, and they said to me that for safety purposes I had to sit beside the door. Well, every time we went into cloud, I got sopping wet. By the time I got to Wave Hill, I was pretty cold. But when I started teaching at Wave Hill, I realised it was a very special community. But they had no activities after school finished. There was nothing for the community to do, except for Friday night. They had the film night, which was all very exciting, and people used to come from everywhere for the film night. So I said to Bob, the principal, I said, Bob, what do you think I introduced basketball? And he said, do you know much about basketball? And I said, sure do. I said, we've got a tennis court out there, I can paint it up. And I said, we've got some contractors down the back, they're putting in the power line. I'll ask them to put the lights on. He said, yeah, well, if that's what you want to do. So before long, we had the lights on, the bibs, and of course, lots of balls, and a whole pile of basketball rule books for people to learn about the rules. And so Tuesday night was the night for the basketball night, and it started off pretty lean on numbers. Well, by the time I was ready to leave, we had Tuesday night and Thursday night, and people were coming from all the stations around, from Mount Sanford Station, you name it. It was the highlight of the week, the Tuesdays and Thursday nights. Yeah, so I'm not too sure whether that's still happening down there now, but it certainly gave them something to do after work. After that, I followed my love for flying, and I found myself down at in Archerfield, Hangar Number 4, doing my trying to obtain my wings. And the fellow that owned the flying school, Gil Late, he's still alive now. He's in Brisbane, and he always laughs. He says, "I still remember the day you walked into my office, and you put a check on the counter, and you said." Do you reckon you can teach me to fly? And the rest is history. On my 25th birthday, I did a flight test out to the back of Archerfield with the examiner of airmen. And when we were coming back, I noticed the one of the hangars, which was usually all locked up when we came in after dark. And there was lights and there was a big banner and I couldn't see what was written on it. And we're tying the aircraft down and I said to the examiner, I said, do you know what this is all about? He said, no. He said, I don't have any idea. Anyway, so we tied the aircraft down and walked in. And then I could see my name on the banner. And then I realised that the guys, they had my birthday because your date of birth with flying documents and that is pretty important. So that was a pretty memorable 25th birthday. I got my wings and had a party at the same time. Yeah. So moving on, I found myself back in Darwin in 84, where I met my husband at the Darwin Aero Club, where we were both flying out of at the time. And our first meeting wasn't too cordial. He brought the aircraft back late. I just knew it, him as A. Mitchell at the time. And I checked the booking sheet and I thought, this aircraft's over an hour late. You know, and I had my passengers all sitting around. We were doing a chicken and champagne sunset flight over Darwin and the hinterland. Anyway, I said to the passengers, trying to keep them amused while I was waiting for the aircraft, which air traffic controller said, oh, it's still 20 minutes out. So anyway, eventually he got on the ground and I said, do you realise I had this aircraft booked an hour 20 ago? And he said, oh, we got way late. Anyway, so I go to get my passengers in there and I check the aircraft out and there was papers and in the nose locker there was used oil containers and you name it. So I went back inside and I said, oh, Mr. Mitchell, do you mind going out and finishing off the aircraft, tidy it up for my passengers? So that was my introduction to my husband. And he still says, she's always on my case. Yeah, so we got married in the air, which was very appropriate. And then Alan said to me, he always had a dream of building an aircraft. And I said, well, why don't we? I said, what's stopping us? And he said, yeah, well, let's do it. So we built a Vans Grunter aircraft, fully aluminium, with 180 horsepower. Took us 6 years to finally get it in the air. And the I always remember the day we went out to the hangar, Phoenix Aviation Hangar. And we walked through the door and the boys were all saying to me, Monica, Monica, pick heads, pick heads. Because what we couldn't decide who was going to do the maiden flight. And what the boys had done, unbeknownst to me, they'd put two 20 cents, they'd glued them together so that there was heads on both sides. So anyway, they flicked the coin up, and when it landed on the concrete, it made a real funny noise. And Alan looked at me and I said, I don't know much about it. Picked it up. I said, heads, of course, heads. He said, give me a look at that coin. So anyway, we flicked it again and he won. He got it. So Trevor said to me, don't worry, you come up in my aircraft and we'll watch it do its maiden flight. So it was pretty pretty nerve-wracking, sort of taxiing down behind Alan, wondering if it was going to get off the deck. And he held it on, held it on. This was on 2-9. Eventually, he lifted off and away it went. We flew that aircraft around Australia for some 12 years. I went down to Perth, across to Adelaide, many times down to Victoria to visit my family. My poor mother, who's now passed on, she used to come out on the balcony and I'd fly in pretty low and she'd take one look and she'd run inside, take a Panadol and lay down. Yeah. Now that brings me to the next topic I'd like to talk about, sports, a big passion of mine. And we think of sport as being something for elite athletes. It's not. It's for everybody. And there's so many different levels of sport. It's amazing. You can have water running with noodles, which is quite... it can be very good for weight loss. You can have anchoring, you know, playing with the grandkids, anchoring the ball. But one thing you do notice is when you exercise, you develop very strong friendships with the people that you spend a lot of time with and lose a lot of sweat with. You develop a special bond. There's one other thing I'd like to bring back about sport here. Interesting trend with older females in triathlons, as I'm heavily engaged with now, this part of my life. We notice when we have a look at the records of the times, it's the older females that are holding the fastest times on different courses throughout Australia and throughout the world, which is very interesting. And in Darwin itself, we've got a very strong triathlon club, of which I'm an active member. Everyone who comes up to compete with us, whether it be for just our local events or the qualifying events, They all comment on the closeness of the club and the willing of the club members to assist with transport or training tips or hydration tips, which is so important here, exercising in the territory. I'm presently training for a big event. It's a World Championships in London in 4 weeks and 2 days' time. And my training week is about 14 hours. I do three swims, three rides, and three runs, and three weight sessions. And if things are running good for the week, I can fit in a Pilates class. I wanted to share this one with you, a very funny thing that happened when I was qualifying last year. I flew down to Melbourne to race in Geelong, and I managed to win my age group and was coming back. And at the airport, and yet when you're travelling to do a race, you've got this big bike box and that comes with you. And I took it up to oversize luggage, and I placed it down on the conveyor belt, and the attendant there, the Qantas attendant, I said, go easy on that, there's a bike in there. And he said, I can see that. And just as he was about to press the conveyor belt to start rolling, I noticed my e-tag on the box was hanging out, and it was going to go through the chute, and I thought, oh, it'll get cut off. So I leant over just to flick it back on, but at the same time he pressed the button to roll the conveyor belt. Well, this guy was so quick, he grabbed me before I actually hit the conveyor belt, and he went down first, and I'm on top of him. And here we are motoring toward to get, and I'm just thinking in my head, put your head down, there's metal here, you know. But he eventually stopped it before we actually got out where the other guys were ready to load it on the cart. Anyway, we gathered ourselves up, and he said to me, oh, what happened? And I said, oh, it was my fault. I said, I leaned over to flick the e-tag up. And he said, oh, I'll get you a chair. You better sit down, you know. And I said, no, look, I'm fine. I feel okay. And he said, where are you off to? And I said, oh, back to Darwin. And he said to me as I was leaving, I said, look, honestly, I'm fine. So I'm walking back to the Qantas lounge, and he said to me, you're sure made of tough stuff up there. Yeah, so I've just got a few notes here. Just representing your country, it's a very special feeling. You don't realise it until they call your name out, and you see the Australian flag there, and you think, it doesn't get much bigger than this. It's a great privilege, and I look forward to it in London. Last year I was lucky enough to represent Australia in Auckland, and even luckier, I came second in the aquathon, which I thought it surprised me. I didn't think I could match them at the top, but I managed to, and my husband was more excited than me. And at the end of it, I said to him, after the race had finished, and they tapped me on the shoulder and they said, oh, could you stay around, please? You've got to go on the podium. So I said to Alan, I said, oh, did you bring the race bag? Oh, he said, I left it at the motel. Well, here I am standing, waiting around in about 14 degrees temperature in a little bit of lycra strip, and it was freezing. And anyway, the English girls that were ahead of me in the age group ahead, they had this big bag, and they saw me and they said, Ozzy, would you like a jacket? And I said, have you got a spare? And she's diving into the bag, and I could see this jacket coming out, and it's got Great Britain written all over it. And I'm thinking, what do I do here? So I said to her, she's handing it to me, I said, do you mind if I turn it inside out? And she said to me, you do whatever you have to do to it. So I did. I stood there for a while with this jacket inside out. But that's a camaraderie that you develop, even though she was from England. There's a special bond when you race together, that particularly women. I notice when we race in Australia, when we rack our bikes the night before, we all get together in a circle And we all know each other pretty well now. We know who's on form and who's not, because they have designated races that you do in the capital cities. And we all bond after we put our bikes on the rack the night before. We all get together and interlock our arms. And we've all got our own special challenge within the race, because there are three disciplines in a triathlon. There's the swim, which a lot of ladies who come from down south find it challenging because of the cold water. They don't get in it as often as we do up here. And when we're interlocking arms, the ones that find the swim a challenge, she'll say, "Please bring us home safely in the swim. Yes, yes, yes." And I'm the one on the bike, because I'm used to riding horses. So I always say, "Please bring us all back safely on our bikes. Yes, yes, yes." And while we're doing this, the men in the same age group usually come over and they say, "What's going on here? What are we missing out on? You know, what's..." And they can't quite work out why we're all so close, you know, even though we're competing against each other. Mind you, race morning we don't talk very much, but yeah, so that's about my story. I might go for questions now. Has anyone got any questions I'd like to ask?
Is it something you fell into, or did you make some choices about it?
I've always been involved in sport, like Victoria. I was one of the top basketball players, and they couldn't understand why I flew to the Territory and left a big future in basketball. Any sport, I just take to very easy. I'm very lucky. I think I have my father's genes. He was very athletic, and anything I start doing, I find it very easy in sport. But triathlons, up here, I used to play a lot of tennis up here. I was very good at it, but my Scottish skin, it didn't like the sun, so I had to change. And someone said, "Why don't you come try..." It was actually Peter Brady, he's a Tyler here. "Why don't you come and try a triathlon?" So I did. I did the first one at Perrap Pool some 20-odd years ago. And I remember running around Perrap, thinking, if my father could see me now, he'd think I'd completely lost it. With this tiny bit of lycra running around the streets, you know, at 7 o'clock in the morning or something. But yeah, once I'd done one, that was game on for there. Yeah, it's a real challenge, and each time you find out a little bit more about yourself, and you get a little bit fitter. So it's a win-win. Yeah, thank you, Robin, for that question about why I got into triathlons. I just saved myself then, didn't I? Have you got any more questions?
Monica, obviously you've got to keep yourself fit. Do you take supplements, or is it just keeping healthy food? How do you get your supplements?
Yes, that's a very good question too. Food and do I take vitamin supplements? Yes, I do. I've actually had to write them down. Food, I'm very particular about what I eat. I try to keep the fat content down. And as far as supplements go, I take a joint formula with glucosamine and chondroitin. I take one of those tablets a day, usually in the morning. I drink lots of water. You'll notice I've got my water with me now. I like to drink water. It's filtered and it's at a level of about 7.2 pH level. I've just got a little ionizer at home, and that'll read out what pH it is. Because when you exercise, you tend to get a lot of acid build up in your system. So it's very important to have your water just slightly above the acid scale, so 7 up is good. And during the wet season, where I perspire a lot after a run, you know, your shoes are full of water, your shorts are full of water, and you've really lost a lot of your essential minerals. Thank you. So I take a good old Cell Vital. You can get it at Woolies in the blue can, and it's one of the training camps I went to at Noosa. The dietitian said that's the best thing you can get, because it's very natural and it has a very, very good balance of magnesium, potassium and sodium without all the food colouring of the others. So, yeah, and I only take that in the wet season where I do perspire a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah, so are there any further questions?
Yes, I'd like to know what you eat during the day. I know that when you're training, you can eat anything, but what would you eat to keep healthy on a daily basis? Just breakfast, lunch and dinner.
All right, Noeline, that's a very good question too. The question is, what do I eat on a daily basis? Early in the morning, the first thing I start with, because your glucose levels are down, you've been, 7.5, sometimes 8 hours without anything except water. So the best thing is to get in some natural glucose, and I prepare the night before. I cut up some pineapple in the bottom, usually some blueberries, banana, pear, apple, and whatever else is in seasons. And I put dried fruit, a dried fig, and three dates. And that's about it. And I put some low-fat yogurt on top. So that's the starters. And that takes me to the exercise I'm going to. And then after that, it depends. If we live rural, so sometimes after swimming on a Tuesday and Thursday, we might go and have breakfast like poached eggs, but I'll have it on multigrain. I'm not one for toast, so I'll just have it on multigrain bread. And then at lunch, we steam up turkey drumsticks. They're very lean. It's a very lean meat, and we steam them up with the vegetables. And we'll just heat that up, or sometimes we might have steamed fish with vegetables, and some of the vegetables, sweet potato, you know, broccoli, and I don't know whether I'm overstepping the line, but I buy most of my fruit and veg from Greenies at Rapid Creek because it's pretty clean. It's either biodynamic or organic, so it's minimal sprays and fertilisers on them, so you're getting the good food there. And I grow some of my own. So, so the evening meal, very, very light, because by that stage, you know, the body's slowing down and you don't need a big meal. So it's either a little bit of steamed fish and vegetables, or sometimes some roast beef and vegetables, or occasionally a salad, you know, tomato, lettuce, and the spring onions. So I suppose you'd say that was a pretty boring diet, but I really enjoy it, and so does my husband, so, yeah.
What about
a little bit, yes. You need a certain amount of protein when you're exercising at my level, yeah. I do take a protein powder, only once a week. It's just a natural pea powder, which I just mix with water, just to supplement. Yeah, it's a protein powder, but I don't buy it off the shelf. The powders you buy off the shelf have lots of fillers and all sorts of things that send the wrong message to your body, and your body can't absorb them. They might puff you up, make you look nice and muscly, but they're not doing the right thing for your liver and your kidneys. Yeah.
Hi, I've got the microphone. Sorry.
Hi,
visitor from Tassie.
Actually. Oh, Tassie, welcome.
I was interested in you said that the older women are keeping up the times and the triathlons, and I was thinking about whether that was indicated in the hormone levels post-menopause and the lowering of the estrogen levels and maybe the increase in other hormones, or whether it was actually a physical thing of them hanging up their aprons.
Very good, very good question. It was, are the older ladies who are faster, has it got anything to do with the estrogen or hormone level in athletes? It's if you have a look at all the records, I've had a good look at them over the last 20, 25 years. Females in Australia, I haven't done it on any other country, they're actually getting slower. So, like the ones in the age group above me, they've pretty much all tapered out. above 64. I'm in the 60 to 64 age group, right in the middle. The numbers are dropping off, and I notice, particularly in Australia, in the 65 to 69, there's probably only three, four really strong competitors in Australia, and they're still holding very good times on the course. And it goes right back in five-year increments. You'll notice, like I might race, say, Geelong, I beat my age group plus the one below and got second in the time in the 45 to 49. So I don't know whether it's got to do with the good food we eat or... it's just a phenomenon. And it's happening with the men as well. No, I think it's more to do with our diet. Yeah, that's the only thing I can put it down to. Yeah. Are there any further questions?
I have a trivial question, Monica.
Fire away.
I've been in Darwin since 1975, and I remember coming from Victoria, and in my first year here, heading off in the middle of the year to the pool and going, oh my God, I'm nearly the only person here, and it's 32 degrees and gorgeous, swimming up and down. 12 months later, can't get in the water. It's freezing. How on earth do you manage?
Oh, we have tricks. The question was, how do we cope with the, I think, what's the temperature now? The temperature of the pool water, which we swim at Nightcliff mainly and down the waterfront. At Nightcliff, I think it's about 23.9 it was. Still a bit cold. What we do, we have sleeveless wetsuits. So we put our wetsuit on and jump in. Yeah. Oh, you'll need a full, yeah, definitely, and at least two or three caps.
And feet and shoes.
Yeah, just to keep you covered, yeah. Talking about cold water, the coldest water I've swum in was Vancouver. I represented Australia in Vancouver in 2008, and they're all worried about me because of I was the only one from Darwin, and... And there was no one from Western Australia, so they were all southerners, the rest of the team, and they were pretty acclimatised. And the water temperature was 12 degrees. Anyway, we had, I always remember, our slot for our swim practice at English Bay was right beside the Canadians. And the Canadian manager was a lady, Angela, who I became very good friends with. She comes from Calgary, and she had a real personality. When the boys came down and they had their little speedos on and they're putting on their wetsuits, Angela said, "Hey Aussies, there's one thing you got to learn over here. It's a privilege, not a right, to wear speedos." Anyway, we got swimming, and our coach was a little bit concerned about me being so slight and swimming in 12 degree water, which I'd never been in, but I reassured him I was going to be all right. And I had two swimming caps on. Well, I did bring three with me, but down on the bus, a few of them had forgotten their caps, so they'd actually got one off me. So anyway, swimming out to the first buoy, we got to the first buoy and everyone stopped and said, "How are you going?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm fine, except I got an ice cream headache." That was the only real thing I had, except when I got on the bike and your fingers were numb. Yeah, that was a bit different, trying to control your bike and change the gears. Yeah, but that was a wonderful experience, and I really enjoyed racing in Vancouver. Yeah, so the secret is don on a wetsuit and dive in. I do. I've been very fortunate for the Women's Affairs to come on, and they've sponsored me for my race entry for England, which, because of I didn't realise there was such a difference between the pound and the dollar, because I haven't been to England before. It made it very expensive. you know, for race entry and athletes' contribution, it was up around 7,500 just to enter the race and compete on the Australian team. And then you had your uniform and airfares and things. But I'm very grateful for Women's Affairs to come on board and help me out with that one. Good question.
What are the countries to watch out for?
The US girls are very strong. You bring me to a point that we all laughed over in Auckland. We're all lined up, and they have us all lined up like little seals, you know, in our wave that was the 40 plus, and there was 129 of us, and they had us all lined up on the wharf. And of course the Australians, we're sort of quite aware of our space, and we don't take up too much space because you're all packed in. But the American lady, she was stretching out like this, and we all had to move around her, and then she decides to stretch her arms, and we were dodging and ducking and diving. And when I got on the podium, the New Zealand lady who came third, she said to me, "Hey Aussie, where's that lady from USA that was doing all those good stretches?" I said, "I think she's still stretching." So you do have a lot of fun when you travel. Yeah, so if there's no further questions, I'll tie it over to Leslie again. Thanks for listening.